too often I think people think of meditation as some kind of a chore, hard work, it's difficult. And it is, in the beginning, when you're getting started, it can be. But really, if it feels like a difficult chore, you're not doing something right. You know, it should be uplifting and brightening and expanding to the mind. I always think one of the best yardsticks to know how well your meditation is going is not so much while you're actually meditating, but when you finish and you get up off your seat, do you feel more awake, brighter, more joyous, or do you feel like you're getting up from a long sleep and you're dull and stiff? You should come out of a meditation feeling more awake and more energized. It's important to remember that joy is one of the enlightenment factors, one of the seven bojanga. Very often, discourse, we talk a lot about the realities of samsara, that in the Buddhist words, you know, old age, sickness, and death. And for this reason, sometimes people perceive Buddhism as being pessimistic or gloomy. I always remember one talk I give in some place, one of my travels, and somebody asked the question after, why do you Buddhists always talk about sickness, old age, and death, and suffering? So that's not fair, that's not all we talk about. We also talk about pain, grief, lamentation, and despair. But then, you know, then I give a more serious answer. But even that, Buddha put those things in there, right in the First Noble Truth, because it is important for us to be not pessimistic or gloomy, but realistic, to face that, you know, this samsara condition is subject to the three characteristics, and sickness, old age, and death are inevitable parts of human existence. Third Noble Truth is that the truth, there is an end to suffering. You know, there is a way through and out and beyond. But even before we get there, we ease our way towards that goal by developing all the enlightenment factors. You know, that includes joyousness. And also remember the principle that can't really be reiterated too many times. A really very important point that will make such a difference to people's lives and their state of mind once they take it on is that you are responsible for your own mind states. As long as you're blaming external conditions, other people, your various hardships, whatever in the outer world, blaming those for your mind states, you're not going to make progress. It's not that those things aren't real. They have an impact on us, but how we react to it and how we hold our mind is, in the last analysis, it's up to us. This applies to, you know, in all situations. Now take responsibility for your own mind states. If you have a negative mind state like fear or anger, this applies also to positive mind states, like happiness. There are three kinds of happiness. The lowest kind is happiness based on sense pleasure. You know, it is a real happiness. You know, you get a delicious piece of cake, you feel happy. It's some joy. But it's very transient, and it's very dependent on external circumstances. It's not liberating. Then there's the higher grade of happiness, is the happiness that arises through meditation, and in particular with the piti and sukha that arise in deep meditation, which you approaching and getting into the jhanas, you experience waves of this kind of joy and happiness. And that's more profound, deeper happiness, and it's not dependent on external circumstances, it's entirely internally generated. Buddha called it the blameless happiness that is separated from the senses. But the highest kind of happiness is transcendental bliss beyond bliss, so the experience of Nibbana, complete liberation from samsaric conditions. So, in terms of our practice, it's good to find ways to brighten the mind and expand the mind. It's another related quality besides happiness. I would say there's three related qualities here: joy or happiness, brightness or luminosity. Expansiveness or openness or vastness, so it's a way it's sometimes expressed. And finding ways to feel that rather than having a narrow, tight kind of mind. And you've often heard me say that I don't like to say concentration for samadhi, although that's a standard definition. Because the whole idea of concentrating is narrowing your mind. I don't see that as samadhi. It's certainly not the definition given in the Visuddhimagga and the Abhidhamma, which calls samadhi stability rather than concentration. I don't know how they got stuck. This seems to happen a lot in translations of Buddhist terminology, is that some early generation of translators picks on a word and then everybody picks it up from them and it just gets stuck. And there's a lot of places in the literature that if you're relying solely on the definition in English of the terms, you get misled. This is really, the worst culprit. We want to have a joyous mind and an expansive mind and a bright mind. The idea of luminosity or light, presence of light. Light is really a symbol or a metaphor for this kind of luminosity of the mind. And it comes up in the scriptures a few places. Guru Nikaya has a phrase that the chitta is, in its essence, is luminous. And in the Digha Nikaya, there's a stanza, a verse of poetry that comes up in two places, with a slight variation, that describes the enlightened mind as being boundless. There's expansiveness, without boundary, footing. In other words, that's a literal translation, meaning not being based on anything, not dependent on anything. One of the practices for overcoming sloth and torpor is that's listed is given as a perception of light to visualize the bright daylight even at night. To have this is like using the imagination or the perception. Bring up that imaginatively, bring up bright light to brighten the mind and help you wake up and break through the sloth and torpor. And I think everybody can see things, everybody intuitively knows, the quality of external light has an effect on your mood. When it's a bright sunny day, you feel more naturally, you tend to feel more bright, optimistic and chipper, and when it's overcast and dark and gloomy, you're not so energetic. But this is also what I talk about, what I've been talking about, not being dependent on externalities. To recognize that, bring up your own inner light. So there are various ways of encouraging these qualities of joy, of luminosity, and of vastness. Different meditations. And it's always good to develop many tools in your tool belt to learn, get at least a little beginning level learning of a few different meditations you can pick up as you need them. In the Suttimagga there's a list of 40 meditations, and some of them are they fall into different categories. In one category are what are called anusati, something like it's usually translated as contemplation. So they're not really like an Anapanasati meditation on the breath, for example, because here you're using, with an Anusati, you're using directed thought and visualization or imagination to work the mind. Some of these anusatis are contemplation of Buddha, contemplation of Dhamma, contemplation of Sangha, contemplation of devas, and contemplation of virtue. All of these have the effect of brightening the mind. With the contemplation of Buddha, Dhamma, or Sangha, you go through the attributes. When we do that chant, Itipiso chant, that's the list of the attributes of the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha, and that's what these meditations are based on. So contemplation of Buddha is probably the most approachable one. You go through the different qualities of the Buddha. Buddha, the awakened one, Arahant, the perfect one, Bhagavan, the blessed one. Go through these attributes, contemplate the qualities raised up by that word. In a way, it approaches like imagining yourself to be a Buddha, and what it would feel like to be blessed. really the closest, I think, in Theravada, traditional Theravada, comes to some of the Tibetan tantric practice where you visualize yourself as a deity. As that little bit Teshuva, Manjushri, you visualize yourself as being that entity. Not quite really doing that with Buddha Dosati, but it comes close to that, contemplating the qualities of the Buddha. Contemplation of Dewas is one that I personally like quite a bit for brightening the mind, bringing up a sense of joy and brightness and vastness. I think it does all of them. You go through the different Dewa realms. Perceive the Dewas in that level of existence, and what it would be like to be among them. Contemplation of virtue is remembering your own virtues. This is something I think. It's not necessarily even as a formal meditation, but it's something good to keep in mind. We tend to be very self-critical. And most people, I think, probably spend more mental energy thinking about their shortcomings and their faults, and all the things they've done wrong and mistakes they've made, instead of remembering the times you were good, kind-hearted, brings those things to mind. Remember your good qualities. There's probably a few people that do that too much. They're narcissistic types that see themselves as being all perfect and good. So I think that's a small minority, really. Then another type of meditation that's good for these qualities are the Brahma Viharas, meditation on Metta, Karuna, Mudita, Upeka, loving kindness or benevolence, well wishing, compassion, sympathetic joy, and equanimity. And particularly of these, Mudita, the third one, sympathetic joy, does bring up a great deal of happiness in the mind. And it's one that doesn't get talked about nearly as much as metta or karuna. It's sort of neglected in the Dhamma talks and literature. But it can really brighten the mind. Mudita is kind of the complementary opposite. Karuna. With karuna or compassion, you're wishing that beings not suffer. So you're focusing on the suffering of beings and wishing them to be relieved of it. But with mudita is the opposite. You're focusing on the joyful happiness of beings and wishing it may continue, may be expanded, may they continue to be happy, may they continue to enjoy the fortune they have attained. Because all beings accept, possibly we could accept the beings in Avicii hell and the lowest of the Narayas. They're the only ones that have unalloyed misery. Every other class of being is going to have some mix of pleasure and pain in varying degrees. So there's going to be some pleasure, some joy in their existence. for the sense of vastness, of boundlessness, anantara in the Pali, without limit, without bound, without boundary. To bring up that feeling in the mind, the contemplations on the formless abiding. Done them here a few times as guided meditations. Without going into it in great detail, the basic idea is to approach these the four boundless states: boundless space, boundless consciousness, nothingness, and neither perception or non-perception. To find them by a process of non-attention. Move from your field of attention, aspects of reality, and see what's left. So the basic instruction in short is you begin with the first perception, it's just your ordinary perception. They call that perception of village, which just means ordinary, day-to-day, ordinary existence. So you just try and be aware of your surroundings. Stage is perception of forest, and in that perception you start with ordinary perception, but you just don't pay any attention anymore to any man-made constructions, so buildings or roads or any of that. Just be aware of the earth and the trees and the ground, the grass, whatever. And then you abstract that away by to the next one is perception of earth. You extract away all living things, plants and so on, and you're just aware only of the underlying earth, the ground, the rocks, the soil. And you hold that as the whole globe of the earth. You keep expanding in your mind the area you're paying attention to. You have the whole globe of earth element, is solid, taking up space. That's the definition of earth element, establish, takes up space. So then you take the next step, which is the critical one, passing into the formless. You cease to pay attention to earth, and you're aware of the underlying space. And because of the nature of space, it can't really have boundaries, so that dissolves very quickly. And you're aware of infinite space. That attention. So now all that exists is your consciousness filling boundless space. So to make the next step, you cease to pay attention to space and be aware of consciousness only without reference to space. Then the next one is nothingness. You cease to pay attention to consciousness. You're aware of nothing at all. And it's actually no thing. Kinshayatana. So there's no thing, there's nothing to label, it's just nothing. But then even nothingness is a concept, so the next, the final one, the most subtle one, is neither perception or non-perception. When even nothingness is too busy for you, you extract away from that. Though that contemplation is very powerful for bringing up the vastness. So to summarize the main points, what I'm trying to suggest here is that what we need to foster in our spiritual life, in our inner work, are qualities amongst others, but I'm talking about these three qualities. expansiveness or vastness, boundlessness. You have a, if you can find that in your mind, a sense of being bright and cheerful and without boundary, expansive, then the meditation becomes not only
say